about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all the things that had happened. While we're talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place in these last days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and beside all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophet had declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' At the same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road, and how it had been known to them in the breaking of the bread." This is the gospel of all.
Thanks to you, Lord. So let us pray, like the disciples, we too may meet Christ on the road. God is the beginning and end of life's pilgrimage. Let us call upon him in confidence. The response to "Lord, we pray to you," is "Be with us on our journey." Lord, we pray to you, be with us on our journey. Father, all holy, of old you made yourself the guide and the way of your people as they wandered in the desert. Be our protection as we begin this journey, so that we may return home in safety. Lord, we pray to you, be with us on our journey. You have given us your only Son to be our way to you. Make us follow him faithfully and unswervingly. Lord, we pray to you, be with us on our journey. You gave us St. Cuthbert and holy men and women in all generations as models for following Christ. Grant that through their example we may live a new life. Lord, we pray to you, be with us on our journey. You guide your pilgrim church on earth through the Holy Spirit. May we seek you in all things and walk always in the way of your commandments. Lord, we pray to you, be with us on our journey. We pray together as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. all-powerful God, you always show your mercy toward those who love you, and you are never far away from those who seek you. Remain with your servants on this pilgrimage, and guide our way in accordance with your will. Direct us with the light of your grace, shelter us with your protection, and bring us to our destination in safety. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Praise to you, O Christ.
So what is food poverty? Food poverty, is it a lack of food? For some, yes. And that's where the food banks and the food networks and the co-ops come in. In the last few months, thousands of people have been fed through these. And many of us have contributed in many ways. As a nation, though, we should expect no one to be left hungry. We should expect no one to not have enough money to support their families. It may be hard to believe, but 4.6 million Britons currently live in food poverty. Now, today, and that number's only going to get higher. We're a rich country, recently rated the 7th richest in the world. Yet millions of people are struggling to access enough food. Food poverty or food insecurity means being unable to buy enough healthy food to meet our nutritional standards. This has a knock-on effect on health of people, particularly so in children who haven't had the opportunity to learn about or be fed on healthy food. What are we going to do about it? In Gateshead Deanery, we've worked really hard to raise funds and to raise the profile of food poverty over the last 8 weeks. But that feels a little bit like a sticking plaster. And maybe this is the time that we start to think about the causes of that food poverty. Maybe now is the time that we start to think about the injustice that's causing this. And what we as a deanery can do about that. We are all children of God, all loved, all equal, and none should be hungry. So let us pray. In a dark and disfigured world, we have not held out the light of life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
In a hungry and despairing world, we have often failed to share our bread. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
In a cold and loveless world, we have kept the love of God to ourselves. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, you are our Father, a loving parent who cares for us, your children. Here today, we are just a few of your many million precious and loved and valued children. Help us to recognise the needs of our brothers and sisters, all made in your image. Give us your daily bread and help us to share abundantly the plenty that we have been blessed with. Amen.
Amen.
Christians were pilgrim people, pilgrimages woven into the very roots of our faith, beginning with Abraham, the first pilgrim. God calls Abraham, who God will later call Abraham, to leave his house and journey to a land unknown. Leave your country and your kindred and your father's house and go on a journey to a foreign land. So Abraham becomes nomadic. He pitches a tent each night and the next morning he takes up the tent pegs and he moves on. And I think this spirit is fundamental to our Christian tradition. We are pilgrim people from the start. And the story of Exodus is essentially a 40-year pilgrimage. And God's people are brought to the promised land, led by Moses. And in the Gospels, Jesus calls the disciples to follow him away from their homes to a journey into the unknown. And this command contains a deep truth for each of us. And the first step in our pilgrimage is always a movement away from the familiar. Unless we let go of the familiar, the safe, the secure, unless we take the risk of becoming vulnerable, we cannot grow. So that speaks to us at this time during COVID, because we've been pulled away from the familiar, really. And now we're having to leave behind the familiar and the known and journey into a place in the future that only God can envision. The pilgrim's physical journey can jumpstart the transformation, as it were, through the radical act of leaving behind the world that is known. Simply leaving home is not enough, of course. So physical pilgrimage has value for its ability to inspire inner change. So we're all called to set out ever afresh on an inner kind of pilgrimage, a pilgrimage of the heart. And we follow Christ on a journey of growth and transformation. Come, follow me, I am the way and the truth and the life. Every outward journey of pilgrimage always has as its true goal an inner journey of transformation. So the essence of pilgrimage is the journey within. And I recall a lovely story from Sister Benedicta, who recounts an early Egyptian recluse who fell under criticism for living a sedentary life. "Why are you sitting here and doing nothing?" one monk asked her. She replied, "I am not doing nothing. I am on a journey." So we can embark on the most amazing journey without leaving our room. But Jesus calls us to embrace new life wherever we are. in our own individual lives, collectively, as a group of Christians, and together as his church. And that means letting go, leaving behind what's become too comfortable, our habits, our compulsions. And it means each morning waking to a new day and saying to God, where do you want me? Where do you want to lead me today on the journey of life? What are you asking me to leave behind? How are you asking me to change? Cardinal Newman wrote, to live is to change, and to be perfect is to have changed often. So as we embrace this time of change, we seek transformation as we follow God into a new future. Amen.
Amen.
Well, here we are at the great Durham Cathedral, and on this day, many hundreds of years ago, the body of St Cuthbert did its final leg of its pilgrimage into this, its great shrine. And so today we finish our pilgrimage, 10 weeks in the making, more than 60 walkers, and 3,129 miles.
Whoa!
3,129.
And £1,978.
Wow!
Brilliant.
So a huge congratulations to everyone who's walked, everyone who's donated, everyone who's contributed in any way. We're going to leave the Just Giving page live for a few more days. If you've been inspired by what you've seen today, please do support us if you can. Whatever you can give will be greatly appreciated. So let us offer what we've done to our Lord. Father, we give you thanks for all those who have contributed to our pilgrimage, for their efforts and generosity. And we praise you for your strength and protection in all our journey. We hold before you all who struggle to make ends meet, the homeless, the hungry, and especially those of our communities in Gateshead. We pray that you will prosper the work of our food banks, aid agencies, and all people and organisations of peace, and that you will inspire us to live and work together for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Gracious Lord, we thank you for your servant Cuthbert, in life a minister of your grace, in death a channel of your glory. Grant that in the glad company of your saints, we may journey on in faith, and at the last be brought home to your dwelling place in joy. Through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Father, we give you thanks for all those who contributed to our pilgrimage, for their effort and their generosity. Open our eyes, Lord, to see your glory. Open our ears, Lord, to hear your call. And open our lips, Lord, to sing your praises. And we have our final blessing. May God, who has shown you a pattern of holy living and holy dying in the lives of Cuthbert and all the saints, bring you to share their glorious inheritance. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and those you love always. Amen.
Amen. Amen.